to reach out to people and select the InSight speakers for the season. And so I was definitely, I just wanted absolutely to include Jennifer on this one. So we're going to kick it off with a short conversation for her. And she's going to talk about magic and monstrosity in Shakespeare's global fairyland, which I'm super excited about. And then I'm going to ask a couple of questions based on her material, and then we'll open it up for questions for you. So I'm going to hand this over and let you introduce yourself. Here you go.
So one, problematically, it's not, they aren't lines that we're sort of spoken at this production. But the Theseus is sort of chastising Hermia and giving her options, right? So she can either marry Demetrius, she can die, or she can become a nun. He uses this the metaphor of a woman as a rose, which is kind of a common trope. And specifically, he tells Hermia that earthlier happy is the rose distilled than that which withering on the virgin thorn grows, lives, and dies in single blessedness. And he's using this metaphor to basically say, you know, you'll be happier if you're married, and if you're a rose distilled in this way, preserved for posterity in some way, than if you were to, grow, live, and die sort of on a withering on the virgin thorn, as he puts it. And one of the questions that this raises, right, is what is a rose for? What is the natural world for? Is it for human uses, for human manipulation? So in this context, or it's in this context, rather, that we get at the center of the play's magical mischief, that, right, with a floral ingredient made, whether it's magical, whether it's potent by being touched, or rather wounded by Cupid's dart or bolt. And to quote Oberon, which he also kind of spoke in this production, it fell upon a little western flower before milk white, now purple with love's bloom, and maidens call it love and idleness. Fetch me that flower, he tells them. The herb I showed thee once, the juice of it on sleeping eyelids laid will make poor man or woman madly dote upon the next live creature that it sees. So this is quite a powerful property that this flower's juice has, and a powerful manipulation that Oberon has in mind, especially when it comes to something like love. A question that I posed to my Shakespeare students in light of this play was, you know, what do we learn about consent and love and desire in Midsummer Night's Dream? How does magic complicate those things? There was a reason, after all, that during Shakespeare's time, love spells, to perform love spells or love magic, as it was called, was taboo. It was forbidden. Oftentimes it was associated with a kind of witchcraft. Which is why I can appreciate the darker interpretation of the fairies in this production, for example. So this idea that magic, even as it was maybe thought of on the one hand as a branch of science, was also, in its sort of worst interpretations associated with the demonic, with the kind of corruption of natural magic. And so not that this sort of forbidden nature of love magic kept people from seeking those remedies out, right, or actually trying them. And in fact, there's a 17th century manuscript at the Newberry Library in Chicago full of magic spells that include recipes or spells for love. And some of it reads in a similar way to what Oberon was doing. I really liked how, in this interpretation, Oberon really is seeming to cast this spell, right, kind of using this recipe in order to bring forth those properties of the flower. And so, some of these spells include, just because I think they're kind of interesting, include directions such as, carving fallen angels' names onto an apple with the blood of a white pigeon, conjuring the devils that tempted Adam and Eve in paradise, so that, and I quote, "What woman soever tastes of this apple, she shall greatly be inflamed with love towards me, so long as I list." So also examples like putting valerian, kind of herb, into a glass of beer or wine and giving it to the person that you want to manipulate into falling in love with you. None of these, of course, are things that I am encouraging us to communicate at all. So it's in this context that we get the occult properties, right, and the hidden secret properties of this now purple flower and the ways that we can transform. And in some ways, this is a wish for a kind of empowerment, right? Or for a kind of control over the status quo or the natural order. And I think it's worth kind of questioning the very idea of what the natural order is. And this is often simply a desire to transform something or someone else. So what to make of it then with one of the play's central unresolved problems or puzzles by the end of the play? Demetrius's ultimate love and desire for Helena. So by the end, he asserts that, quote, "all the faith, the virtue of my heart, The object and the pleasure of mine eye is only Helena. To her, my lord, was I betrothed ere I saw Hermia. But like a sickness did I loathe this food. But, as in health, come to my natural taste, and that's, I think, a really interesting wording. Come to my natural taste. Now I do wish it, love it, long for it, and will forevermore be true to it. One, how much do we take this to be true? But alternately, two, you know, how much control or say do we really have over the ways in which we transform? What is the natural order of love and desire and attraction? What is one's natural taste, right, as Demetrius puts it? As in Hermia's case, at the beginning of the play, what does it mean to fall in love with somebody beyond a boundary that you or society or your father thought was there or sought to establish? And then in Helena's case, how much choice do you really have in the matter? And this brings me to some lines that I think are really kind of beautiful, though in a hugely problematic context. And in this production, Helena says the first line of it, but I kind of wanted to continue with the other lines. And so this is before Demetrius is under the influence, shall we say, of the flower, so pre-magic, that's what we want to call it. And in any case, this is when Helena is following Demetrius into the woods. Demetrius is really not being very nice to her at all, and basically tells her to stop following him. To which she responds, you draw me, you hard-hearted adamant, but yet you draw not iron, for my heart is true as steel. Leave you your power to draw, and I shall have the power to follow you. And again, I think these lines are really kind of beautiful, again, in a problematic context, but also fascinating because Helena is drawing here on one of nature's mysteries during the period for the metaphor, that of the mysterious, occult, secret, inexplicable properties of the adamant or the magnet. So this idea of the magnetic pull, quite literally in terms of scientific discovery, or magnetic attraction. And I think it's brilliant that Shakespeare embeds this metaphor here to speak about the mysteries of human attraction. So in what ways is this a natural mystery then, an inexplicable but natural pull, or in what ways is it a kind of magic? And again, it reinforces this idea that attraction and desire are mysterious, are in some ways inexplicable, are potentially magical. So it brings me to the question, is magic in the play a disruption of the natural order, as in Oberon's attempted kind of manipulations of things and his intentions for, say, Titania? Or is magic a corrective or a restorative of natural taste, right? Which is what we question in what Demetrius, or how Demetrius ultimately ends up. And this brings me to the idea of difference, and also, though not exclusively, of this idea of monstrosity. So what makes someone a monster? And these are lines that I think it just ended up getting cut here, but it follows one of the things that Helena is saying just after she makes the comment about the magnetic attraction. Helena hints that it comes, or being a monster comes from undesirability. And so she does refer to herself as a monster, but she says the lines, I am ugly as a bear, for beasts that meet me run away for fear. Therefore, no marvel, though Demetrius do as a monster fly my presence thus. What wicked and dissembling glass of mine made me compare with Hermia's smooth eye. And then, so she's drawing on the occult properties of magnet in the one instance, and here she's drawing on this idea of monstrosity. And then there's the actual sort of monster that appears in the play, thanks to Puck and Oberon as Bonham's transformation. Oh, monster, so strange is the reaction that he gets. And it brings me to the question of how does monstrosity figure in this play? What does it enable Shakespeare to explore, challenge, and question? And I would say to some extent that it's the idea of difference in transformation. So Bonham's transformation is meant to be comedic, as it is, but the lurking danger or taboo, of course, is that of bestiality. You see that very well represented in this production. My mistress is a with a monster is in love, says Puck. Right? So Bonham is turned into a monster that is part beast, so that Titania will be copulating with a beast. And that is actually Oberon's intention. He actually, he names a number of different animals and different beasts that he hopes Titania will fall in love with. And this is in line with the context of monstrosity in Shakespeare's time. Monsters were actually part of the natural order, but just not normative. Right? So they were just kind of beyond what was considered normal. Francis Bacon called them queer generations. The idea that that monsters are somewhat beyond nature, beyond generation, they're still a part of it. So in other words, they're exceptions to the rule. And as one of my colleagues we talked to, is Shahani, who is also a Shakespeare scholar, has pointed out, and I quote her here, Bottom hints at the dangers of mixing and mingling with foreign entities. And in other words, it's the fear or threat of miscegenation. And critics have seen Bottom's monstrosity as a kind of, or embodying more subliminal fears about early modern cross-cultural and cross racial encounters, for example. So we do get the presence of India in this play, right? The problematic Indian boy that's at the heart of this very strange conflict between Titania and Oberon, for example. The spice of Indian air that Titania mentions. And the spice of Indian air, namely of the fairy's global reach. So it's kind of it's sort of ambiguous just how much of the globe fairyland is sort of a part of, right? Is it going to be relevant to England that they can kind of travel to these other, you know, regions? And this speaks actually to the anxiety about the global natural world and its materials, not to mention its inhabitants, the transformative properties of the flora and fauna from abroad, and this idea that they could actually alter, for example, English bodies, so whether it's a kind of racial transformation, ethnic transformation, or really any kind of change of bodily constitution. So this is very much a threat that's sort of in the air during Shakespeare's time. And I think it's also appropriate that magic was often, or came to be associated with the foreign, and this idea of kind of dark magic, black magic, using exotic ingredients from abroad, for example, kind of starting to relegate magic to sort of a corruption of science or a corruption So monstrosity and magic then speak to the many layered anxieties about transformation. The monstrous, I would say, is the unexpected, the divergent, the surprising or the different. That's what constitutes the anxiety, that the unexpected or the divergent is bad, right? It's a bad thing. It doesn't follow the natural order. Love and desire and attraction, as in Titania and Bonham, can lead to monstrous births, monstrous transformations. But I want to offer this up as something I've been thinking about in relation to the play, just kind of toss out there. The idea that in this play, love, to some extent, functions as a kind of differentiator, as transformative magic, functions specifically as a way to kind of transform difference as monstrosity, and I'm thinking of Helena in this instance, to difference as the beloved. And I think this is speaking a little bit to the kind of written in interchangeability of the lovers and the ways in which they start to make these comparisons in order to make distinctions between them, right? And that becomes a way to determine who is beloved, right? Who's sort of a monster. And it's love, right, that ultimately marks that difference as desirable or difference as desirability. So I return then to one of my first questions, as I've been mentioning here, is transformation good or is it bad? Which transformations are brief and passing? Which transformations last and are permanent? And why? And I want to end by thinking about the very idea of transformation then, in light of both the fear of and desire for and the anxiety surrounding permanence and the disruption of the status quo. And I think it's interesting that the idea of transformation pops up so often in Shakespeare's plays, as well as the works of his contemporaries. And I'm interested in how that's written about. Right? The words that are used to express transformations, various changes of form in constitution, thought, feeling, perspective, and in relation to love in this play, especially, John Milton, for example, writing later in the 17th century in his Paradise Lost, would write a speech for the moment that Adam first sees Eve. And it's this is kind of described as a moment of transformation. And Adam says, but here, far otherwise, transported I behold, transported touch. Here passion first I felt, commotion strange, in all enjoyments else superior and unmoved, here only weak against the charm of beauty's powerful glance. And I want to emphasize here that transformation is being figured as a kind of being transported, right, being moved. And Helena's desires to transform, she talks about transformations in terms of translation. Some of the lines that she uses, she tells Hermia, were the world mine, Demetrius the invaded, the rest I give to be to you translated. Oh, teach me how you look, and with what art you sway the motion of Demetrius' heart. In other words, change me, right? Tell me how to transform into you. Tell me how I can be translated into you. Bottom's transformation also, at some point, elicits a response in these terms as well. Quince reacts, you know, bless thee, Bottom, bless thee, thou art translated. And finally, in one of the otherwise often voiceless apologies, right, and this is problematic, final moments on stage, she is the one who observes the force of transformation among the lovers. And she says, but all the story of the night told over, and all their minds transfigured so together, more witnesseth than fancy's images, and grows to something of great constancy, but howsoever strange and admirable. We can see the different ways that change is noted, being transformed, transported, translated, transfigured. And I want to end by focusing here on that, that prefix of change, trans, as a beautifully open prefix, one that spans definitions that include across, through, over, beyond, outside of, surpassing, transcending. One that splits open the borders and boundaries of worlds, bodies, and ideas that enables us to cross them, to transgress them. We are in a moment in our world, I think, where people are yearning for a kind of magic, for some form of enchantment, sometimes for escape, but more often for possibility and for transformation, for a kind of change on a global scale. And by that, I also mean to include the theater and Shakespeare. And I think this is where the Midsummer Night's frame speaks in particularly profound ways to our moment, showing us how magic enables transformation, enables possibilities, and how transformation itself can be seen as a kind of magic, one that enables new perspectives, new awakenings, and new beginnings.
Interesting to hear how the so many of the same things that we would talk. So the first couple of days of rehearsal are spent doing table work, which is where the actors and the director and the dramaturg and the team all sit around the table and talk about the ideas in the play, not just the ones that affect their character, but the global ideas of the entire production. And so many of the things that you spoke about today actually very specifically came up in the rehearsal process. I just noting a couple of the idea of consent being a major issue in the play, especially as we approach this work in contemporary world and conversations that we're having. The idea that Oberon, by putting the love juice into Tanya's eye, is creating an atmosphere or the lover's eye, because there's an absence of consent of what's about to happen to them sexually or romantically. So I think really interesting that it came up in both places, as well as the idea of transformation. So that is definitely something that we're fascinated with the Aberson version.
Yes, yes.
You know, one of the things that really strikes me is the idea that the fairy world and the transformations that happen within the fairy world affect what happens in the natural world, in the world of Athens as well. Do you have any ideas about that? Would you like to talk a little bit about the Athenian formality, that how it transforms because of their experiences in the world?
So you were talking about the kind of the ways in which the fairy world is transforming kind of the human realm. And sorry, it's the question about kind of what the product of that is.
So many of Shakespeare's plays involve us going into a natural environment and then coming out of it somehow transform and transfigure. And this one does as well with it.
Absolutely. And I do think it's, so I did a lot of work on recipes. So on Renaissance recipes. And a lot of this has to do with looking at the natural world and the ways in which, they were kind of thinking about the human place in the natural world. And I think it is really striking that in Shakespeare's plays, whenever he has, or he kind of locates a lot of these, a lot of transformations in a space that is sort of part of the natural world. And I think it's in line with some of what I was talking about with this idea of these kinds of inexplicable occult properties that are kind of latent in the natural world. So whether in kind of the materials that you find out in nature, and the ways in which they have a kind of power. They can have power over humans, they can have power over other kinds of things. And the human urge to, I think, want to discover what that is, to be able to use it for their own for their own intentions, but also how much of nature kind of lies still beyond human comprehension. So, even when they're trying to figure out how does a magnet work, what is it that gives it this property of being able to attract or repel, and realize that there's so much to discover because it is part of kind of God's creation. It's part of this idea that nature is divine. And so I think that, I guess I'm thinking about this play and the way that I usually kind of see the way nature working in some other texts. I think I see the kind of residual effects of feeling those occult, kind of hidden, secret properties that are kind of interfering with humans whether they know it or not.
The idea that things are interfering with humans and we don't recognize what's happening around us, especially since Puck and Oprah, I am invisible, and yet it can immediately affect the humans' lives without them having any sensibility about that. You talked briefly about the complexity of Demetrius not having his eye repaired and what the implications of that are. Hugo will dig into that a little bit.
And actually, this is the kind of question that I'd be curious what others think as well. Just in terms of what is the effect of seeing the end of a play, end of this play in particular, and seeing that Demetrius, he's the only one who hasn't had his eyes fixed, right, or hasn't had them kind of restored back to their original. And I think that there's so many implications there anyway, and that's I think part of it as well. But also, I think what's interesting about that, and the more that I've sort of looked at that moment, I am really struck by how he interprets it as returning to his natural taste. I just think that's so strange. And obviously it's ambiguous whether he truly, or whether we are to take it as such, right? Whether we are to take it as he has truly found his senses and somehow Oberon was the one who knew that he was supposed to be, in love with Helena, or is that the nature of transformation, where he just takes that current feeling and sees it as it must have been natural all along, not knowing from whence that transformation came. So it opens up, I think, a lot of questions. I'd be interested to hear what anyone else thinks about that. But it's always been that problematic
instance
in the play, right?
I've always been fascinated by that moment as well. So
so many people think that Shakespeare is so simple that everything's tied up at the end, but usually there are a lot more questions than there are definitive answers or definitive choices that have to be made in the text. And so it's really exciting to open up those things where what does Demetrius really feel and believe, and is he still affected by the love? Who knows? And I think that's a question that you have to address sort of as a character and
within the production yourself in some way.
Yeah.
Actually, I mean, I have a question about that.
Okay.
So for the, for the production, I mean, what was sort of the conversation around that?
Well, I can speak to Ishmael's decisions. Ishmael Muhammad was the young actor that was playing Demetrius. He's a student at A&T, and we're so thrilled to have him here. He really felt that he, within the framework of the play that we had constructed as far as the oppressive nature of Athens and the oppressive nature of Theseus's court, that where women were devalued and status is valued, that the opportunity to please the status quo, the opportunity to please Aegeus, clearly be financially recompensed for dating or marrying Hermia, all of those sort of things led him to deny and squelch his natural love for Helena, which he is denying and denying at the beginning, but through his transformation or through his experiences in the boy, is able to actually recognize, no, I love Helena, I don't love Hermia. Hermia belongs with Lysander, and I was trying to just support the status quo. That was Ishmael's thought, right, from the beginning. Yeah, and it was funny because our Oberon, I think he had played Lysander when he was younger, or one of them, and so he had never heard that choice before, and so he was eager and excited kind of like to hear about what Ish's thoughts were on that. But I think that is, I've seen it done a multitude of ways where like sometimes Puck out of mischievousness goes and puts the healing flower on Demetrius's eye as well, which is an option, and then the audience has the opportunity to be surprised by the fact that Demetrius actually is in love with Helena, or not. So what's more exciting for you in your world? I mean, I think Preston's excited by complications. So, more complicated, more fun. I see a question right here, sir.
Superstition?
You got it.
How much does it play in that particular world?
I would say it plays a great deal of a role in the world, although I don't know that they would necessarily have thought of it as superstition. I think that's something that we would sort of map onto the early moderns as superstitious, whereas I think it was very much more a part of their reality about how the world worked. This belief that there were spirits kind of going around and part of interfering with the human world, whether it was fairies or whether it was divine spirits, demonic spirits. And so I think that it does speak to the ways in which I think everyday life was a little bit different. And so the kinds of beliefs that they held and the kinds of behaviors that they would kind of do in response to those beliefs are very different from what we do now. But that's also what makes it so magical. Why does Shakespeare turn Bob into a donkey and have the fairy queen sort of have this romantic relationship with the kind of man donkey? And I turned into an ass. and so I think, I think there are different levels to that. So on the one hand, it is meant to be comedic, right, on some level, and absurd. But also, as critics have kind of noted, it's also gesturing to a real kind of fear or threat of monstrosity. So the threat, in having Titania, who, well, is not a human, but is a fairy, I guess, nonetheless a different species from bottom-turned beast or animal, it does sort of offer up the suggestion, the uncomfortable suggestion of bestiality. And this was part of the idea or theory of monstrosity in the period that species, different species shouldn't, populate and this is what causes monstrous births. And it was a way to explain away difference. So whether it's deformed babies, a deformed, whether in the animal world or in the human world, it was a way to kind of explain things away as sort of something unnatural, some kind of unnatural appropriation that's happened, as well as a natural appropriation by virtue of being influenced by the divine or by some kind of evil spirit or evil kind of influence. Does that answer your question? I think that's why kind of Shakespeare put that in, is kind of playing with that as something that we can laugh at, but also something that might make us.
Would you call that a taboo? A kind of situation, like shouldn't happen, wouldn't happen.
Right, absolutely, yeah. Okay. I'm really kind of pushing on that a little bit.
Mm-hmm. So just thinking about the way that Oberon is manipulating Titania, not only does he manipulate her by putting the love juice on her eyes, but then he humiliates her by having her cognitive disease. And so the idea that of this power in order to get exactly what he wants, the changeling child, he's willing to do sort of anything to his wife,
right,
as a humiliation. Other questions? One more. You mentioned, and this came up in our table work as well, how big is Fairyland, considering that they're going all the way to India, the votress of Titania's order, was there on the beach with her and talking and had a child. One of the things that came up for us was the idea that the status quo in India is now being reversed because it's the child of a king who has been stolen. I imagine with all of your experience with Shakespeare and early modern drama, you would know the origins of the changeling child. And so can you talk a little bit about what that means in our world here in the play?
In this play? So about the Indian boy. And it's interesting because we actually get two narratives of the Indian boy, right? So Oberon, in Oberon and Puck's idea of the Indian boy, Titania has stolen the boy from the Indian king. In Titania's version, it's the boy of the Rothans, right? And so, and then she wants to take care of this boy after his mother has passed away. And, what was the question?
Can you talk a little bit about what the
implications
of a changeling
is? Right, so a changeling was sort of, was a child that was replaced by fairies. That was one of the kind of ideas about what a changeling was. An infant that was sort of stolen away and replaced with a fairy child. And it's a little bit unclear in this version whether this Indian boy is a kind of fairy child, or a product of fairy, or is this sort of the human child, but nonetheless they're talking about the Indian boy using the term changeling. And it's interesting because of the ways in which that role slips between the more kind of supernatural or superstitious fairy realm and the human realm, also in light of what critics have seen with this kind of response to India as some of the early anxieties being voiced about trade, right, and about imports coming in, and what does it mean to kind of be mining the East for these valuable products, and the Indian boy is also being figured as a kind of property, right, as a kind of product that can be kind of traded around and kind of purchased, right. Like Titania says, Fairyland won't buy the Indian boy from me, and yet she's sort of tricked into giving up her kind of ownership of the boy. And that is the kind of conflict that is about this ownership. Sorry, I don't know if that answers that, but I think I'm just always interested in how the kind of changeling role is also kind of being conflated with the role of a kind of item, right, as available for purchase and available for trade, and what that does to kind of the idea of human property.
That
the actors are so athletic that we need to train them in that sort of thing. For the fight scenes, specifically the lovers' battle, where all the lovers are running around and Hermia's jumping on poor Lysander's back all the time, we have a fight coordinator and a fight director. His name is Jim Wren. He's part of our, he teaches at UNCG, one of our university partners. And so he works on that with them. And for a fight of that size, usually you have to have a fight call before the performance. So before we open up the house and let the audience inside, there's at least been about 25 minutes making sure that they go over each fight, each physicality to, for safety. And so that is, the fight scenes are all done once we're here. Puck is, just happens to be an incredibly physical performer. She trained at Columbia, I believe, and that program's noted for its physical acting, and she just came in fully charged, ready to go. I know she's quite delightful in how she can manipulate her body and how precise she can be. But that was a conversation. All of the magic moments were a conversation that happened within the rehearsal room about, is this a magical moment, or is this a conversation? Are we just straight up talking to each other, or am I manipulating you with magic? And what does that physicality? How strong is that pull of magic, or how soft? So sometimes, you know, Demetrius went to sleep and Oberon was just gently pressing him down into the ground versus flipping over Puck. So that was always a conversation in rehearsal of the director and the actors about what level of magic it was and what level of magic was needed in the space at that time. Yeah. We were very lucky to be able to go to New York and cast actors there as well as cast locally. And so, you know, when you're doing a play like Midsummer Night's Dream, where you know it's going to be super physical, you look for those actors that have that capability when you're casting. Any other questions?
Was there an antecedent to this?
Pardon?
Was this a play based on something that Shakespeare? Was there an antecedent?
Did it have a previous? No, this is one of the few that doesn't actually have, you know, the source material of Theseus and Hippolytus is within the Greek mythology. But usually, you know, Comedy of Errors, for example, was based on another source material. A lot of Shakespeare plays, especially the comedies, are selected plots from other areas and has appropriated them and rewritten them to be in his style. But this one actually doesn't have beyond, like, Greek mythology. It doesn't really have a previous story that I know of. Do you?
We have another resident.
Another resident Shakespeare.
Yeah. Pyramus and Thisbe, of course, is also famous. And we get that kind of meta-theatrical moment of people performing a thing that's also a Greek myth. But beyond that.
Yeah, so Pyramus and Thisbe is a story that existed in Theseus and Hippolytus. Those figures exist, but not within this framework. Yeah, the story of Helena, Hermia, Lysander, and Demetrius is all Shakespeare. any other questions for our scholars?